Rod MacBeth and the Tri-City Morning Show.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
Good to be back.
You guys were on a bit of a hiatus for a while, and you got back together about 2009 or so?
Yeah, somewhere in there.
Well, actually, 06.
06?
We got invited to go on a cruise ship across the Devil's Triangle with the Bare Naked Ladies. So why wouldn't you do that?
Bare Naked Ladies, Devil's Triangle, nothing good can come of that, right?
Yeah.
Well, no, we were found eventually.
Yeah, that's great. It is. You guys have had some great success, and with success, of course, comes some bad stuff too. But I look at you as one of the success stories to come out of the Vancouver music scene. You have a lot of influence that you've put on other bands, and you've been influenced by certain bands. How did you guys all start? What happened?
Well, we were kind of the weirdo in everyone else's band that we saw. And so we'd go into the, a club or something and see some guy. I want to be in a band with that guy one day. And eventually it happens that you're all kicked out of your other bands. So, we started in late 87 and in a basement in Vancouver and sort of somehow just started writing right away, writing songs. And there wasn't really a market for that around here. People sort of, the Canadian music scene was more about imitating what was happening in the rest of the world at that time. So we went south to kind of get recognized, and where whatever we were doing must have seemed exotic.
Yeah.
it just seemed weird here. And then and kind of came through the back door.
You said something, and I never really put my finger on it until you said it right there. In the 80s, we didn't have songwriters here. I mean, we had Brian Adams and Jim Vallance, and that was about it, right? And for the music scene to explode the way it has over the past 30 or so years, and you guys being a part of that, is just fantastic, isn't it?
It is. I would say, though, there were a lot of songwriters. They just were encouraged to be a little more imitative of what was going on in the rest of the world. And now Canada is known as a place where things can be new and fresh, and that's all changed.
Nice. You guys are here, you and Pat are here, and you're going to play a couple of songs for us. We're going to talk. You're playing at the Kaleidoscope Festival happening over at Town Center Park, and you are on stage on, is it Sunday or it's on Sunday, 5 p.m. Sunday,
yeah.
Right?
Should be fun.
Yeah, it'll be a great time. We've got this brand new, beautiful plaza stage there, and you got the sort of an amphitheater, and there's nothing quite like it outside of Stanley Park and possibly in Surrey at their amphitheater, so we got one here.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Pat, you're a drummer. You've traveled around the world doing that, and how many drummer jokes do you get a day still?
That's the first one all week right there.
Unless he's with the band. Yes, he's with the band and we're making fun of drummers.
In the 90s, those all shifted. They kind of went over to trombone players.
Yeah. I have some trombone players. Then there were, in the 80s, there were drum machine jokes.
Yeah, drum machine joke. Yeah. I mean, who can control that stuff?
Yeah, and I watch you play, and there's some drummers that just sort of go through the motions and that, and you actually hit the drums. You're not scared to break the drums.
I like to... It's rock and roll. It's exciting. You know, I'd like to get right in there and let's stir up some business.
Well, speaking of getting right in there and stirring up some business, why don't you guys play us a song?
Sure. What do you want to do? How about this, Pat?
You just go.
Look outside, it's nice enough. We'll stay in with all our stuff. This is dedication, more than love. My cowardice is what you need, so your vanities can breathe. I plant your flowers in my should, 'cause I'm a low-level
That's great. That song's almost 20 years old. It's still one of my favorites.
I think it is.
Yeah. It's just Make You Mad. And that was your, I think, second most successful song in the chart action when it comes to radio airplay on that.
I don't know. I think it's a little farther down for our songs, maybe in the fifth most successful.
Okay. you never know with these things. And it's all just all what radio station wants to play. How did you find that when radio stations started playing your music? Mm-hmm. Because generally, radio stations ignore the good stuff and they just go with what everybody else is, kind of the lemming effect, right?
Well, I guess what happens is you know, back in those days, there were these big record companies, and we went and found one that was interested in us. And then they say, we think this is the song to go with. And we'd go, well, I don't know, that one's kind of dumb. And maybe, how about this one? And they say, no, we're right. So then you say, okay. And they put the song out as a single, and then that kind of draws attention to your album. And the radio stations just get given that song.
Yes.
And back when they were 45s that they were given, then they could turn it over. And they say, well, maybe we like this other song better. You'd have some surprises.
And that's, you know, being a music guy, because I love music. I can't play a guitar. I can't sing. This is my way of expressing myself by playing your guys' music here. Mm-hmm. And to have that finding that little gem that somebody won't play that you can play on yourself, or that we can actually play here at our station, because that's what we do. We look for songs that are mm-hmm. gems that, you know, people deserve to hear. Your guys' songwriting, how does that come about? Is it just every day something's going through your head, or is there a certain format you've got?
I think so. There's no format. Our music sounds like our music because of the four personalities and the four people's experience and influences and where we come together. So you get in a room, people go, well, why do you sound like that? I go, well, I guess it's because our voices and our drums and our guitars sound a certain way that we've got used to, and that's how we interpret the world. But I think you just go around collecting language. You know, somebody says something interesting, you bookmark it in your brain or write it down, and somebody is noodling on their guitar in the back of the van, and you hear something that they play that's cool, and you say, what is that? It's where it all starts.
Nice.
There's always stuff going on in your head. Once in a while, I might send him something. You know, everybody's got an iPhone and things of this nature to get ideas across or to save it. And then once in a while, lately, it's like there's an email of like, usually when Craig is off the road from those two projects and he finished doing some yard project, he's like, hey, I've got 5 days available next month. Where are you guys at? And then it's like a whole slew of crazy emails and one guy going, okay, let's try to control this. And then we figure out another email system and we find 5 hours next month, you know. And sometimes Craig and I will get together and work on some things and go, well, that was fun. And then a month or months later, Doug will hear it. And soon, Doug, our bass player, as soon as he puts something on there, it really becomes, you go, oh, now it sounds like odds. There's something going on with his
He might be the secret force.
Yeah, right. We don't know anything. It's just all him.
Right. So, Pat, you as a drummer, are you a lyric guy? Are you more of a rhythm guy when it comes to writing the songs?
It's more about the music,
yeah.
You know, certain lyrical things once in a while, but mostly, or after the fact, I go, wow, you said that. That's great, Craig. I like that.
But the lyrics have been out for 25 years.
It's mostly music things. Like, I'm always, since I was a kid in bands, like, somebody's playing something, and most of the time, people are plugging in their amp, they're going, and they're just noodling. It's totally, they're not even aware of what they're doing. And right. Nowadays, you got to run around and record anything somebody's doing, you know, or just keep stuff, tapes rolling. I go, what was that thing you did? They go, I don't know. I go, well, you were on that fret and you went like this, and you know, sometimes they remember it, but a lot of times not, and you think that just sounded awesome. And that's what any song you love, whether it's a Tragically Hip or the Stones or Sloan or whatever, you go, those guys were sitting in a room and a guy is just noodling. You know, it's not like he went, I'm gonna craft a hit. He went, I did this, and a guy played drums to it, and you go, we all grew up listening to rock and roll, and that's a good feel, and it goes along with that riff.
That's interesting, because sometimes you'll hear even a sound effect of a vehicle driving by, and you'll think, hey, maybe that's where that guy who wrote that song got that idea for that song from that sound.
Yeah, that's kind of cool.
Yeah. So odds are at Kaleidoscope on Sunday, 5 p.m. It's a free show for everybody. Now, is there any truth to the rumor that you guys toured with Warren Zevon?
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
Talk about, you sort of mentioned the odd, well, is, I guess that's how you got your name. How did you get the name The Odds?
Well, the name The Odds, I was the last guy in the band at the time, was come from, what are the odds of us getting out of this place?
A place like this.
It was sort of like an upcountry gig, and it was not easy. You know, the ones where there's just a bare light bulb in the room and
tourist British Columbia. Yeah.
Well, there you go. I can't. You can think of the place, and yeah. It's a really rough hotel, and so that was where it came from. But it came to sort of more represent, like I was saying earlier, the attitudes we had, and that's the name story isn't really that interesting. It became a kind of a bad name because the internet was invented, and there's two things on there, gambling and pornography, and it's pretty hard to find us.
Yeah. Right, sandwiched between the two odds, yeah. But it just seems that your personalities would have synced with Warren Zevon because he is an interesting person.
Yeah, that was a cool story. Somebody, you find everything now is an anniversary. There's the Coquitlam having their 125th. Our first album, it's the 25th anniversary of that album as of a couple of weeks ago. And we didn't know that, except somebody posted online. It says, happy 25th birthday to this album.
Yeah.
And Warren heard that record and liked it and wanted to do a thing which he had done before where he takes a band out that's a unit and you are his band and you open the show as well with your own stuff. So we did that for his Mr. Bad Example tour in the States and some Canadian dates, mostly the States, and he was a beautiful guy.
Yeah, he was, yeah, and a very, very talented songwriter.
He was a hero of ours and remains one and a great mentor, and we learned a ton. It was our first big, because our album had just come out, our first major label album, it was our first, hey, get on a really cool tour bus and be with a rock star, and basically he mentored us and gave us don't do this kind of lessons, and he was very experienced in the don't do this because he'd done all those bad things.
Nice, like taking a bunch of kids out. Okay, son, don't do this. So you've mentioned tour buses and buses and that. How do you guys get around now? Do you still hop in a van, or when you go on your tour, do you just fly there and get a rental car? What do you do now?
Yeah, that's a lot of flying there, and then spent doing a couple dates in an area and coming back is what our life is like now. But every once in a while, we'll go out for a little longer than that, but not generally.
Yeah.
The world has changed.
Now, do you find, when you're not touring, do you miss the road, either one of you?
I think both Pat and I like field trips. We like getting out and seeing people and experiencing new things. Sometimes it gets to be a bit of a treadmill because it's not always new things, but anytime you change the scenery, it's great. I don't know if I miss it because it hasn't really gone away.
Nice.
You know, we're still busy. We spend a lot of time in airports.
You do, and you spend a lot of time. And you guys, let's talk about this in a sec. Do you want to play another song for us?
Sure.
And then we'll talk about the Corner Gas and Kids in the Hall and stuff like that.
Sure.
We've got The Odds here. They're playing at Kaleidoscope Sunday, 5 o'clock. Free show for your family. Kaleidoscope is happening all weekend long, Saturday and Sunday. Here's The Odds.
Okay.
Yeah.
2, 3, boom. Selection. I've avoided all detection and the tender bits underneath. All with window dressing and calculated guessing and a bark bigger than my teeth. Cause it was the suit that got me the game. It was the tear that got me the girl. I'm a sheep in this wolf's clothing. I'm a picture that I'm holding of someone who swallowed up in symbols, wanting what I don't need. Your sympathy's the answer. I'll have temporary cancer, but that's not what I'll have you believe. Cause it was was the suit that got me the gig. It was the tear that got me the girl. I'm a sheep in this wolf's clothing. I'm a picture that I'm holding of someone who is cool. Someone who is cool. Someone who is cool. Someone who is cool.
Someone who's cool. Yeah, I love that. That was your most popular song when it came to sales and ad in Canada, now north of the border here.
I think it was the number one song, we could say.
Yeah, it's great. It's still one of my favorites. You wrote that song for a soundtrack, I think.
Yes, very good.
Was it Friends?
It was Friends 2.
Friends 2, okay.
So it's Special Friends.
Just go back. I've got a decent memory on some things, and I remember like Pat used to play drums for Bryan Adams. I think you were on the tour that Adams almost became pizza when he had his ill-fated skydiving attempt when he jumped out of the plane.
That's right. Yeah. Oh, were you with the Fox back then?
Yeah.
That was like right about now. Whatever that was.
Yeah, it was. So Pat is the drummer for the Odds. Amazing history with him. Besides being Adam's drummer for a long time, you're with the Odds now, of course. But you've done a lot. What have you done over the years? Things that pop to your head.
I got to say, in recent years, there's a lot of people from the Tri-Cities area that I have become friends with and get to work with. So, hi those people.
Those people are great. Yeah, there's a lot of them.
Lots of different stuff. You know, the Odds. We sort of had a. We kind of hit a point and took a bit of a break.
Yeah.
In about 98, and then there was internet in 98, but I didn't really have it, and I was doing a couple shows in Europe with somebody, and my wife said, "Hey, you need to get a hold of Colin James because a friend of mine was playing drums with him, and then he was going to leave to go do something else." And I'm like, "Oh, that'd be cool, yeah." And I knew Colin a bit.
Yeah.
So I got in with Colin when he was just kind of winding up his little big band 2 era. And then, you know, we never had played together, but knew each other over the years in the clubs, you know, late 80s. And then I started saying, I was going, "Man, you should get together with Craig. You guys should do some writing." And Craig and I and the band had this little project that was instrumental, kind of 60s soul and R&B, this soupy thing, and just a little hobby thing that we loved to do. And I gave Colin that. He's like, "Oh man, I like this." And then they ended up starting to do some writing. And then next thing we knew, we did a record called Fuse with Colin, and that was when Craig entered that world. And he's pretty much the last 15 years, Craig has been working with Colin on some writing and sometimes recording. And so that stuff, and then lots of local guys, you know, up-and-comers.
Matthew Good,
I did some stuff. Yeah, he's an up-and-comer from the Tri-Cities area.
Yeah.
A couple of records with him. That was fun, and some tours, and a good friend. Well, Barney Bentall's sort of a good band friend from way back.
I got to get Barney in here one day. He's got so many stories,
oh,
and we keep missing each other. Yeah,
we can help.
Good, we'll do that.
We'll bring a giant band, and we'll get Barney and us and his son Dustin.
Dustin,
yeah, singer, songwriter.
Then we're gonna get Ridley Bent in here and get the whole Caribou Grand Ole Opry thing. Yeah,
I think Ridley played at the what do they call it, Golden Spike?
Did he?
A couple years ago.
So. Yeah, yeah.
And in those days, I was either with. Doing shows with Ridley or Dustin, so you had to. Well, I'm in Northern Alberta with Dustin, and those guys are at Golden Spike days.
Yeah,
but yeah, there's so much good stuff, you know, if you're playing some other friends and all of us, you know, sort of end up being side men sometimes with other people, friends, and there's like you were saying, songwriting. There's a lot of great singers and songwriters from. All around, you know, Tri-Cities to Stanley Park.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we've got a wealth of songwriters here, and it's nice to see. Now, Craig, you, what are your influences? I know you've toured with people. While you just mentioned Colin James there. Gin Blossoms are another one. That would have been an interesting one.
Yeah, those guys were a band when we went south, as I mentioned earlier, to Los Angeles. They were another band around town, sleeping on floors of people's, apartments and stuff with us, and we did lots of shows together down there and stayed friends, and as they broke and sold lots of records, they took us along back in those days when we had our early albums, and we're still pals. I did an album with Jesse from the Gin Blossoms. Pat's on that one too. I think all the odds are Northy Valenzuela, and together we wrote the Corner Gas theme and stuff, and Jesse and I still work together when we can.
And just somebody sent me a text a while ago, and I'm thinking of musical, and it just popped into my head. Your sister is supposed to be quite musically talented as well.
Yeah, my sister and my mom.
Yeah?
My mom's a violinist, and so growing up, that was our daycare, you know, go to rehearsal. My mom ran the concert society here, the Triad Concert Society in Port Moody when I was growing up, or later on, and was taught at Douglas College and places violin, and my sister's a cellist, and she's in Calgary. She's another one of the... I'm the least talented of the family.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. What about your dad? Did he do anything?
Oh, he's very talented too. He was a singer when he met my mom.
Yeah.
I'm outing him now, but he was mayor here in Port Moody for a while too, and he was involved in civic politics and development and all kinds of things. He's a pilot. His major talent. Is operating a vehicle that flies through the sky.
Nice, that's very cool. What are your, like, anybody in your family got the musical bug, Pat, or is it?
It's funny. I guess my mom played piano. I just had this chat with someone the other day. And then, you know, somewhere along the way, she showed me a few things early on, but I guess she just sort of had grown past it by the time she was, which is weird, 30. And you know, my sister played a bit, but my brother and I both got the rock and roll bug when, you know, XL on Main Street and Led Zeppelin albums came out. And so my brother, he plays guitar, but he plays at home. He never went really like playing in bands like I do and that, you know. So
right.
And my dad would drive ships for the Navy. So
cool.
He was in the sky. He's on the sea.
Yeah, right on. That's
our,
great.
Our parents were protecting us.
Yeah.
That's very cool. Now, the Odds are playing Kaleidoscope Festival Sunday, one of the bands that's on the free stage at the Plaza. Actually, admission is free for all of this. And the Odds are just one of the Canadian bands that everybody loves. It's just, hey, they're Canadian. And they're kind of like, you're kind of not the best friend, but the friend you really didn't know you had that's sitting there when you hear one of the Odds songs saying, yeah, and you start grooving with it. Now, you worked with Kids on the Block.
Kids in the Hall.
Kids in the Hall, sorry, yeah. Kids in the Hall. And
but if we had worked with New Kids on the Block, that would be awesome.
Good.
That would be really good.
Different kind of music, yeah. And you also, Brett Butt, because they used part of that song for the closing of Corner Gas, right?
Yeah, well, the opening and closing of Corner Gas. And, Jesse and I wrote Not a Lot Going On for that and Happy Place, which is, that's on an Odds record later.
Yeah, right on. You guys, it's been phenomenal. Do you have one more song in here, or do you want me to play one of your songs that we have in the studio here?
Yeah, we can play again. How about that one? We could do Not A Lot Going On.
We can do that.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because usually you only get 28 seconds of this song on Corner Gas, so, and you don't know who it is. So now,
right.
We always claim, it's a bit of a joke of ours, that we're sort of, as you said, you hear our music and you go, oh, that one. Yeah, I didn't know who did that.
Oh, you did? That
you
was
did
you?
That was you. We're sort of like secret agent musicians who do secret things and release them and no one knows it's us.
Nice.
But this one we did, and yeah, anyway.
Ken, and I just want to say before we go, and thank you so much for doing this with us.
Yeah.
And there's bands playing all day, right?
Yeah, there is. Yeah, we're going to talk about that in a bit.
I think there's some other people I know that are playing there. So.
Greg Drummond, he's awesome.
I think the Brickhouse guys are playing there.
Brickhouse are playing Boom Boom, Cassandra Bangle, well as Jim Burns. Phenomenal.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he's an upcoming guitar player. He's going to do all right.
He's a young cat who's got a few things. We can teach him a few things.
I remember I was doing a show at Club Soda, and I was waiting for him, and all of a sudden I hear this. Bang, bang, bang. I'm like, where the heck is that coming from? If you played Club Soda and you go down those long back stairs to get into the alley where Richards and Club Soda, that they share that, and there he is. He's all peed off because somebody was supposed to get him and make sure he is up there. So, of course, Jim, due to an unfortunate wreck, he got rear-ended when he was pushing a car and he lost both of his legs. So he's got those prosthetic legs, and he had to navigate up the stairs. So I went down, and I was his guitar roadie for a few seconds when I grabbed his guitars and took him up. But just a fantastic guy, but probably the most ornery I've seen him that night. Yukon Blonde is also playing.
They're great.
What time are they on?
They are on Saturday night. They are on at 9 p.m.
Saturday,
they're great. Be in Regina.
Jim Burns is on after you guys on Saturday, though.
Oh, yeah, we'll get to hang with Jim. We love Jim.
Yeah. Fantastic. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, the odds are here. They are part of Kaleidoscope. It's happening at Town Center Park. It goes Saturday and Sunday. The odds are playing 5 o'clock on the Plaza stage. And here's a song they're going to say, oh, yeah, they did it.
Yeah, you're all like watching TV on the radio.
You can tell me that your dog ran away, and then tell me that it took 3 days. I've heard every joke, I've heard everything you say. You think there's not a lot going on. Look closer, baby, you're so wrong. Roll my eyes back into my happy place. I'm always gonna need this sense of space. And in the amber wave under a rolling cloud, I can't hear what you say cause you're talking so loud. How many times you gonna get me wrong? Yeah, yeah, yeah. You think there's not a lot going on. Look closer, baby, you're so wrong. That's why you can stay so long, where there's not a lot going on. You could use a glass half full of something strong to help you see the emperor with nothing on. Double your dose if it's over the counter, cause you're sad. So wrong.
The odds. The theme song from Corner Gas, we just say that because that's what everybody knows it from, but there's not a lot going on. The odds are part of Kaleidoscope. They're playing down at Town Center Park, 5 p.m. on Sunday. We've also got Saturday, the bands that are playing are going to be Boom Booms, Greg Drummond, the Yukon Blonde, and then on Sunday we have got Blackthorn, we have got Brickhouse, and the odds, and of course Jim Burns. Going to be a fantastic day of music. Yeah. Craig Northey, Pat Stewart are here. You guys, phenomenal, and it's just made my day. I get to finally do something on the radio with you. I mean, this is awesome. I love this stuff.
Let's do it again.
Yeah, you guys, it's an open invite. If there's ever anything, a project you're working on, or you want to come in and just play some, there's a thing here. So you want to come in, you got an hour, I will give you to just play music that you love and that influenced you. And it's kind of an open an open pad here.
Fantastic.
For you to do that.
Awesome. Thanks, Rod.
Okay. Now, time is on our side, not on our side, sort of. And I wanted to play Heterosexual Man. I can do the recorded version.
It'll sound better. You need electric guitars.
Okay. Perfect. You guys, thanks so much for being here. Kaleidoscope, see them live Sunday at 5 p.m. Have a great show, guys.
Thanks, Ron.
Thanks.
Weekdays starting at 6 a.m., the Tri-City Morning Show. Expect more from your radio. CKPM FM 98.7.